when it feels like the world is on your shoulders and all of the madness has got you going crazy. It's time to get out, step out into the street where all of the action is right there.
Hello there, Lollygaggers. It's another week. I'm sure Samantha and Irby are dancing, a little rhythm of the night, kicking the show off. A little, you know, upbeat. Upbeat tonight. You know, we are into the baseball playoffs. We're going to chat a little college football here in a second. And we're going to talk about the state of some of these NFL teams, whether they are contenders or pretenders. First things first, Samantha, as always, of course, I'm joined by Samantha Bunten and Matthew Irby. Let's kick this off, Samantha, with college football, because we have had our first major shakeup, I think, with the college football rankings. I'm talking, of course, about the playoff rankings, you know, who's going to be in that final four once we get to the end of the season. So, rankings just now out, Georgia, Ohio State, Michigan, TCU, that is your new top four. Any surprises there for you in the way this is shaking up?
I don't know. I'm feeling generous now. Now that I just heard DeBarge, I'm in a much better mood than I was like 3 minutes ago. So this is great. I feel like it doesn't that song make you feel like you're at one of those beach resorts, like where you're like, wow, this is like really cheesy, but also I love it here. That song makes me think of.
Oh, it does. You know, I actually can see the music video every time I hear it. I can actually see that.
Yeah.
And it's like some salsa club down in Miami.
You know? No, way cheesier than that. Oh, the video. Yeah.
The video, like,
okay,
yes.
Okay, yeah. No, I'm thinking like, the aesthetic in my head when I hear that is like a really cheesy tiki bar, probably in like New Jersey. Like, where all of the drinks are frozen and all of the drinks are bad, but, like, you're having a great time, like, dancing with, like, I don't know, old people or something? Who goes to those? I don't know. I love a cheesy beach bar. So, DeBarge just made me happy. So, maybe I'll be nicer about the college football rankings now? I don't know, man. It's weird. It's weird, man. It's a weird year. Like, okay, Georgia, Ohio State, sure, you could flip them. Whatever. It's fine. I'm having a hard time believing that Michigan is going to be able to hold on to that number three spot. But we'll see. And I'm going to defer to you guys on TCU because I actually have not seen TCU at all this year. So all I know is what I've read about them. I sort of felt okay about it because I looked at who was behind them. And I was like, nope, 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 nope. So by default, I guess, but I'm gonna defer to the two of you on that. I'm good with one and two. I'm good with flipping one and two. I think it's fine that Michigan is there for now, but I don't think they'll stay.
You know, I'm really glad that she brought up TCU there, Irby, because I was pleasantly surprised that TCU was four, and I absolutely do think that they are worthy.
Oh, okay, that's interesting.
Right.
Okay.
I wasn't expecting it. I was not expecting TCU to actually crack into the top four. Obviously, if a couple of those top four teams hadn't lost this weekend, that wouldn't have happened. However, I'm buying TCU, Irby. I don't know about you.
Yes, I absolutely am buying these guys. I'm also actually in the same party here of surprised that they are four and not five, and not finding some excuse to keep Tennessee in there. Though I disagree, if you have me doing my top four, if I'm one of the voters, maybe I am, you don't know. This is my top four. Exactly like this. TCU deserves to be there. You know, the Big 12, for whatever you want to say, the future, blah, 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 that stuff, it is what it is, and it is a solid conference with some good football, and TCU currently is undefeated in that. And that's not undefeated with having, yes, they've got their wins over West Virginia and Tech, stuff like that, but you know, they've beaten Oklahoma State. They beat Kansas State. You know, and Oklahoma as well, but as we found out that Oklahoma ended up being incredibly fraudulent. So the thing for TCU left is that you've got road. The road, we will find out. Here's the thing about TCU. TCU deserves to be there, and even if they were the five, I wouldn't really be concerned about it because they would move themselves up. Their next 2 weeks, they are in Austin this week, and then they are in Waco the week after. The wins over Oklahoma State and K-State, they are W's. Absolutely, they were home games. Not your fault. That's you play the schedule in front of you. They got the job done. Now you go to Austin and you go to Waco. You win those games, you absolutely deserve to be here. So they're 11-0 after that. It's Iowa State, which might actually be the toughest game because TCU kind of has a little bit of history there of, hey, everything's going great. Trip over the cordless phone. So we'll see. But this is a legit TCU team. The offense it can put some serious points up the board. I worry about the defense. This sets up for, you know, College Game Day. It's going to be in Austin this week. It is a primetime game on ABC, and it has the potential, with both teams being completely healthy, to be one heck of a shootout this week in Texas and TCU. That could be a lot of fun.
Oh, I can't wait for that game. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Now, do I expect the Longhorns to win that game? Of course not. I just said I think TCU should be fourth in the country. So, no, I'm not expecting Texas to win that. But I do think it's going to be a fun matchup. Samantha, anything else you want to add here to the college football rankings before we get into the NFL?
I'm not officially acknowledging anything until we get our 18 playoff.
You know, that's, yeah. Mm-hmm. Right there with you. What is it, like 2 years from now, I think?
Maybe. Unclear.
Unclear? Like, that's the best way of putting it. It's unclear.
I feel like you should know. I feel like you should have a date. Like, when are we implementing this? Like, the overhead cost and preparation for this is, like, zero, right? Like, you could just say, next year we're going to have an 18 playoff and you could do it. Like, I know they have some things to sort out with the bowls and whatnot, but, like, you know, you could just pick a year and say this is the year and do it. You could do that. But the NCAA, of course.
Okay. Let's get into this NFL content for the week. Now, there really wasn't a lot on the schedule. So how about we do this? We're going to go through and we're going to identify the teams that we're going to call them the middle teams, okay? Like, they are the ones that still are up for debate in terms of contender or pretender. So, in other words, we're not talking about the Bills, the Eagles, the Cowboys. You know, there's no debate there between contender and pretender with those teams. We're also not going to be talking about those other teams, like the Panthers, for example. There's no argument to be made for contender or pretender. They're just straight up not contenders. So with that being said, we've got 11 teams we're going to look at where there is possibly some debate. So we're going to go through this. It's going to go by division from the AFC East to the NFC West. So let's start here. Samantha, the first team on the list there that is up for debate, the New York Jets. Where are you at with the Jets, contender or pretender?
Oh, I know where I want to be with the Jets and where I probably really am. I love this. I think it's great. I think the Jets have a lot to offer. I think they're way ahead of schedule. I think there's a chance they make the playoffs if you look at their record right now versus what they would have to do the rest of the season to sneak in, depending on what you think the minimum number of wins it's going to take to get into the playoffs. And I think they have a shot. I mean, do I think they're going to get destroyed as soon as they get there? Of course. And also, I mean, as much as I hate to say it, because, like, look, we all love Zach Wilson, right? We all want him to be good. He is a folk hero. He's tremendous. We love him. But, like, you know, you can't, like, win playoff games if all you do is throw, like, 5-yard screens, which is what they have to do because it's the only way they can keep him from causing them to lose. So as sad as that is to say, I guess it depends how you define it. I mean, I think you can call them a contender if the question is, yes, technically they could make the playoffs. But I also think they're like a pretender that is still in the process of morphing into a contender. And I think the Zach Wilson thing is going to be a problem because he's probably going to play just well enough to potentially hang on to the job and create problems going forward. It's Jared Goff syndrome. Jared Goff syndrome. I think I have to go pretender even though I don't want to.
Have you, I don't know if you've seen this. It was floating around social media earlier over the weekend. I think it's actually, I take that back. I think it was yesterday that I saw this. There was a fan out there, a Jets fan, that put this out on Twitter. He's flipped a coin. He flipped a coin for each week of the NFL season and potential playoffs for the New York Jets. And so far, his coin flip has been spot on. He's predicted the wins and losses to a T. And he actually, his coin, now I don't know how far down the rabbit hole you want to go with this, Samantha, but his coin has predicted that the Jets lose in the AFC Championship game.
Uh-huh.
Not buying that.
Well, you have a 50-50 chance. It's a coin. There are only two choices. So you have the 50-50 chance of getting it right. So, sure. Okay. I mean, I will tell you that, like, in terms of, like, randomness, like, we did use a coin one year and allow the coin to pick every game in our football pool for one season, basically because we wanted to know if we were better than random chance, and the coin did about as well as we did. So I don't know what that says about us, but that we are just as bad at picking games straight up as everybody else is. You know, obviously, notoriously volatile thing to bet on if you're doing it all season long, but yeah, it's a coin. Come on.
One other way, well, I guess, to look at this, so the Jets are floating around 500, so 50-50, I mean,
yeah.
There's many different ways to look at that.
You guys are talking about the coin. At this point, the Las Vegas Raiders would probably take that coin to do their play calling.
It's not a bad idea. Okay, Irby, how about you? Jets, contenders or pretenders?
You know, it's a little bit of drinking the Kool-Aid, but I'm going to go with the contenders. I want, and it's a drinking the Kool-Aid. It's a want. It's a, you know, there's definitely some holes and there's some concerns with this Jets team, but I would be almost hypocritical of myself because of what we talked about last week, where I said, yeah, the Bills will take care of business here. Talk to me in a couple weeks when they play again. Jets won. You know, it on the field, the Jets got the W, so I have to kind of lean towards, yes, I think this is a legit Jets team that can make some noise, and if they can keep the momentum going, awesome. Can they trip over their own feet? Sure, but I'm gonna drink the Kool-Aid and say contender.
You know, I can't quite get my finger on the Jets. Like I want to say they're a contender, I really do, and certainly, coming off of last week, yeah. I mean, they kind of look it. But I'm still not buying it. I'm just not buying them. Obviously, they're better than expected, but I don't think they're quite there yet. I think next year, maybe, they could be a contender. All right, Samantha, next on the list, the Miami Dolphins. Contender or pretender?
I think they're a contender. You know, we had a hiccup earlier this season, but that was really more about extremely irresponsible decision-making, not talent or because Tua is looking like he's going to be okay, at least for now. I think they're pretty legitimate. You know, there are some holes, definitely, but I think they're a pretty well-coached team. I think the talent is there. I'm not sure how far they can really get, and they are, you know, part of the thing with these East teams is, like, what are the chances you're really getting three playoff teams out of the East or four playoff teams? Like, it's not necessarily that we can't, you know, we could say, okay, the Jets are a contender, they're not a contender, and then they do or don't make the playoffs. But, like, they all have to play each other, like, a lot. And this division is essentially the division that we thought the AFC West was going to be. That hurts these guys record-wise. But in terms of talent, yeah, I think they're a contender.
Irby, how about you? Dolphins, contender or pretender?
I'm going to take contender as well, especially, you know, like Samantha mentioned there, you know, you look at the when this team was essentially in concussion protocol for 3 weeks, it's the reason for the negative in point differentials. And, you know, there are holes. There are concerns with this team. But, you know, it's a they're going threes, three wins, three losses, three wins. So now they got a new set here. But it's a, I 2-1 in the division. Yeah, I'm taking contenders. This is a legit Miami team that can make some noise. And to double up on Samantha, what you're saying, it's crazy to talk about. I do think three teams come out of this division in the postseason. The four, yeah, it's utterly crazy for us to sit here and do it. But the Patriots are only a half game out of making all four teams in the playoffs, and the team in front of them is the Chargers. So anybody trusting the Chargers to hold that spot?
I'm going to agree with both of you on this one. I think the Dolphins are contenders. I think what separates them from the Jets is that talent, Samantha, that you're talking about. I think they're a more talented football team. I think they're going to be capable of reeling off a nice 2-3, maybe even a 4-week stretch where they're able to pull away from the Jets, where the Jets are still going to be kind of, you know, half on, half off. But no, I agree. Contenders. All right, speaking of those Patriots that Irby just brought up, Samantha, they are up next. The New England Patriots, contender or pretender?
I think this one's easy. I always consider them a contender. As long as Bill Belichick is coaching this team and it has not been decimated by injuries, I will consider them a contender. So I don't, there's not much debate there. Like, you know, are they going to make the playoffs? Are they going to finish? They can finish last in this division and still be a contender. Like the way that this is shaking out. But for the time being, short of just really, really catastrophic injury news, I can't look at them as anything other than a contender.
Irby, Patriots, contender or pretender?
Contender as well. 1-4 of your last five, and doing it with the defense. They are restricting the points of their opponents, and it really doesn't matter how good or inept your offense is. If your defense is holding them down, you're going to find out ways to get points, especially a Bill Belichick team that in that five-game stretch, you know, aside from the one weird game getting blown out by the Bears, they're holding teams under 20. So they keep doing that. Yeah, yeah. This is contenders. I'm not betting against the Patriots. Won't take that bet.
It's almost like their head coach is a defensive guy. Who knew? I'm also taking the Patriots as a contender for basically the same reason as Samantha said. Bill Belichick's there. They haven't been destroyed by injuries. They're a contender for me. All right. Let's move over to the AFC North. There's only really one up for debate in the AFC North, Samantha. That's the Cincinnati Bengals. Where are you at with the Bengals?
Pretender. Look, I love Joe Burrow. I don't want to say this, but without Ja'Marr Chase on a team that was already shaky on the offensive line and very shaky defensively, that has regressed a lot from the season they had a year ago, I can't see them as a contender. I just don't think they're going to be able to get there. Now, the one caveat that I will place on this is that they didn't look a whole lot better last year at this time than they do now, and then they got hot at the right time. So we always have to consider that a possibility. And then Joe Burrow is a phenomenal player, and while they, I mean, I thought they would do something prior to the deadline to help out in terms of trying to sort of spell the situation with Ja'Marr Chase, because they don't have another receiver who is similar sort of in profile in what he can do, and that's obviously been sort of the thing that has fueled this team, of course, is the connection between Burrow and Chase, which is somewhat about chemistry, but it's also about being the right kind of receiver. And boy, and the rest of those guys on the offense just don't have the same skill set to do what he does. So I hate it. I'm sorry, Joe Burrow. I love you, but pretender.
How about you, Herbs? Where do you have the Bengals?
This is a tough one. I really don't know. So I'm going to talk about them for a second, just kind of see where I convince myself. That's about how much on the fence I am with these guys. You know, when it's election day, you kind of making this last second decision, because this is a team that, yeah, when all the weapons are healthy and they're firing at all pistons, this is a team that can score a lot of points. And we've seen that at times, and we've seen the defense take care of business. And Joe Mixon, what he just did, I mean, yeah, that's great, and it's Carolina, but whatever, it's still good in the NFL to get five touchdowns like that. So I there's holes, there's concerns, I know the injuries, you know, the hangover from the Super Bowl, all that. So I don't know. I the more I talk, I think I just talked myself into calling them contenders. That's contenders probably, that looks like maybe with like the shadow of the word pretender. I'll do that. I'm going to say contender, but if you look at the shadows, it says pretender.
I'm saying pretender. I don't think it's a Super Bowl hangover. I think last year was fraudulent. I don't think the Bengals were as good as they played. I think they were, like Samantha said, they were hot. They got hot at the right time, and they made a run. I think that was their shot, because that team just, for me, is still not as well as they played last year. So, pretender. Moving on to the AFC West. One team here as well, Smith, and that is, of course, the Los Angeles Chargers. I'm fairly certain I know how you feel on this one, but let's go ahead. Contender, pretender.
Nothing enrages me more than the Chargers. Which, yeah. Sorry, Chargers fans. I don't actually dislike your team. I just, they make me insane. Like, Justin Herbert is wonderful. This is one of the most poorly coached teams out there right now. And I say this as somebody who really likes Brandon Staley and wants him to do well. He seems like a really smart, thoughtful guy. He's very likable. He doesn't know what he's doing. There have been a lot of bad in-game decisions made by this coaching staff. Really disappointing, because this is a guy who I really have liked to see do well, but I don't think he has it. They have a contender roster, and they play like a pretender. And 9 times out of 10, when that's happening, you almost end up almost always, the team underachieves, and they end up in the pretender category. So, yeah, it's a contender roster, but they're not playing like it. So, yeah, total frauds as far as I'm concerned.
Irby, how about you? Where you got the Chargers?
And just on cue with that, you got the Chargers the next two Sunday nights. Yay! Because this is a weird team. This is the Chargers, honestly, the best game they've played, the most complete game they've played is when week 2, when they lost at Kansas City. Outside of that, their wins, I know everyone, well, they got 5 wins. Yeah, well, go back and look at those games and tell me what was impressive about it, because nothing's been impressive. It's just they find a way in the end to get the W. And that works well, but these guys got shellacked by Jacksonville and Seattle. And I know that we're seeing that Seattle is legit, it seems. This is a Chargers team that on paper, and when you look at many of their matchups, it's like, yeah, they should get the W. Where's your confidence in saying that? Like, these guys can absolutely win these games. But what's the confident level? I don't have it.
I am also going to say pretender for the Chargers. Maybe that's how we get all 4 AFC East teams. And if the Chargers are, in fact, the top competition for the Patriots for that spot. Okay, let's switch over to the NFC. Samantha, we have a couple of East teams. I think you can figure out at home who we're going to talk about based off of the parameters of this discussion. So let's start with those Giants. What are you thinking here, Samantha? Contender or pretender with the New York Giants?
Contender, absolutely. This is one of the ones I feel the most strongly about. I think Brian Daboll has shown himself to be the anti-Brandon Staley, if you will. No, but he's been an outstanding coach. I mean, he has taken a team that actually, like, imagine switching the coaches and the rosters between the Chargers and the Giants. And the Giants would probably win the Super Bowl if they had the Chargers roster, right? Mm-hmm, We're talking about polar opposites in both of these. Giants, not a great roster. So I suppose you can call them a contender or a pretender in that sense, but they're winning football games. And the way that they're playing and the way that the coaching staff has figured out to cover up the flaws on that team and figure out how to use the things they do have going for them suggests that they will be able to continue doing so. Now, it's in a different season, I would say it would be tough to get 3 playoff teams out of the NFC East. But the NFC is a garbage fire this year. So we could easily get 3 playoff teams out of the NFC East. So even if we are all acknowledging that Philly and Dallas are absolutely taking 2 of those spots, we're not going to talk about them today, as Bo mentioned, because we know they're contenders. But I want to put the Giants in that category, too. They have problems. They have a lot of problems. But they're not letting it bother them. I'm pretty convinced at this point.
Irby, how about you? Giants. Contenders or pretenders?
Contenders. This is a... You know what? Screw it. I'm going to do it. This is an 11-win team.
Yeah.
This is all said and done. Yeah. The Giants will have won 11. I was going to say 10, but no. This is an 11-win team. And think a few months ago, if I had sat here on this show and told you guys this is an 11-win team, y'all are probably kicking me off and finding somebody else because it's – but this is great coaching. Giants win 11. Wow, that's Giants win 11.
I'm also going to say a contender. I'm not willing to go to 11 wins for the Giants in this one, but I do think they are a contender as well. Let's go out to Washington, Samantha. Now, we're going to, because they've decided to go back to Taylor Heineke, we're going to actually call this football team instead of Commanders. So football team, the Washington football team, contender or pretender?
Yes, good job. You guys have earned back football team. And really, I want that for Washington fans because you guys have suffered tremendously in the recent past between Dan Snyder and Carson Wentz and just all the horrendous things that have gone on there. Great fan base. You deserve better. I'm so happy that you have Taylor Heineke back again. I so badly want to put them in the contender category because now that we're back to football team and now that we've gotten rid of Carson Wentz, and you know, as you know, this podcast loves Taylor Heineke. We are very pro-Taylor Heineke around these parts. And we are pro-Washington football team. However, I mean, if you were asking, are they going to the playoffs? Well, no. Like, they're not going to be four NFC teams in the playoffs. No matter how bad the NFC is, I just don't see it happening. But I don't think they're quite there. Also, there are so many problems with this team, like things going on that aren't necessarily about football that affect the things that happen on the field. Like, Taylor Heineke is fantastic, but, like, he can't overcome, like, everything that Dan Snyder, like, throws in the way in an attempt to, you know, essentially burn down his own house. So, yeah, I'm going to go pretender here.
Irby, how about you? Where you have a football team?
Taylor Heineke, contender. The name, the nickname, football team, contender. The football team that plays in Washington, D.C. this year, however, is a pretender. Sorry, can't. No, too much ahead of you, too much in that division. Nope, nope.
Have you ever thought about going into politics? That was a master class of dodging the question. Well done.
He answered it.
Did he, though?
Like a politician, yeah. I answered it, and then I threw other stuff in there.
It was a very conditional answer.
If you could see right now, Bo, I've got a half thumb up right now looking at you. Thumbs up. Thumbs up.
All right. I am also going to call the pretenders. I do think Tyler, wow, a whole new quarterback. Taylor Heineke, I think he does give them a couple more wins. I think they could maybe even peel off a division win or two with him at the helm. But they are, in fact, pretenders. All right. NFC South, Samantha, let's start with the Falcons of Atlanta. Contender or pretender?
Big pretender. I can't with these NFC South teams. We have watched the Falcons. Like, first of all, they're largely devoid of talent on defense. And we have watched this team go, like, way up on somebody and then blow a giant lead, like, as though they are still in the Super Bowl playing against the Patriots over and over and over again this season. And sometimes they manage to hang on, and sometimes they don't. But either way, I'm not buying this. Like, I like Arthur Smith. I like what they're doing there. But come on, guys. Marcus Mariota? Really? You're not going to sell me Marcus Mariota. I'm not buying.
Irby? What do you think about the
Falcons? Oh, yeah, this is pretender for me as well. Pretender for this year, pretender for the future, for the exact same reasons that you're saying it. This is a team that's going to finish close to the 500 mark. And fortunately, that might actually make you a playoff team in the NFC South, finishing just below 500. You may actually get into the playoffs. But this is not going to help you in long term. This is not going to help you in building something that can be sustainable. And so, yeah, I mean, you're fortunate enough that you found a way to get wins against San Francisco and Seattle. in the long run of things, it might have been better to have lost those games and be 2-7 right now and looking at draft picks to help continue building. So, yeah, pretender this year, pretender in the future right now.
I agree with both of you. I have a hard time really thinking of a team that's going to come out of this division with a plus 500 record. 500, maybe, but not plus. Falcons for me are also pretenders. Let's talk about those Buccaneers.
You can't have 500 anymore, Bo. It's got to be sub.
Oh, God.
17
games.
Right.
17.
Yeah, it's got to be.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, you're right.
It's going to be
sub.
8-9. 8-9 division winner.
God, you're right.
And that means for a team to win this division, one game under 500 at 8-9 would mean somebody here has to win and go 500 the rest of the way. Tampa or Atlanta would you go have to go 4-4 the rest of the way. That's what's even crazier. Is I can only see that happen.
Oh man. Okay. Well, Samantha, let's talk about the Bucks then. They of course tie with those Falcons at 4-5. Contender or pretender?
Contender. They're going to finish the season 9-8, squeak into the playoffs, and then have a quick, quiet death. Early in the postseason. Now, I can't see a scenario where they don't win this division. They are far and away the most talented team in it. And they've had a rough patch lately, but I think they're going to settle down. I think they're going to get it done. They are not anywhere near the team that we thought that they would be. But I still think they're a contender. A contender with a very low ceiling, but a contender nonetheless. And I fully expect them to win this division.
Irby, how about you with the Bucks? Where you at?
I'm a pretender for long term here. I just don't see enough from this offense to make that much of a dent. I'm hopeful that this team can do just enough because they do finish the season in Atlanta. So I'm all here for 7-9 Tampa playing 7-9 Atlanta for the division title. Yes, please.
But sir. So are you saying that whoever wins this division isn't a contender?
No, I'm double pretenders.
Double pretenders.
Double pretenders.
That's how bad this division is. The person who wins it will not be a contender.
Yeah, no. Yeah, it will be, okay, great, you have a playoff spot. That's awesome. You're like the Minnesota Twins. Great, you got a playoff spot. You're not going to do anything with it.
Oh, no, the Twins. Oh, the ultimate insult. Oh, no. I don't think you're not wrong, though. No. I mean, I don't think you're wrong. Twins.
I am also saying pretender with the Bucks. I agree with Irby. I think this division is nothing but pretenders. We're about to get into another one right now. Samantha, let's talk about those Saints. Contender or pretender?
I mean, do I even need to? Do I even need to? They're worse.
Not really.
They're worse than the other two, which I was split on, and you both called pretenders. And also Andy Dalton. That's all I have to say about this.
Andy Dalton is like instant pretender. Instant. Kind of like with Carson Wentz. You know, you pick that one quarterback, and you're immediately a pretender. I like
that. Whoa. I'm not not being that mean to Andy Dalton. No, I'm not bucketing Andy Dalton with Carson Wentz.
I mean,
too far, Bo.
I will. I got no problems being that mean.
Too far.
All right. Irby, how about you? Where are you at with the Saints?
Oh, super pretender. Yeah, absolutely. Even your offense, everything. Pretender. And the only thing that you will hold on to when this season's said and done in New Orleans is that hopefully the record's good enough that you can continue the rebuild. You shut out the Raiders, which normally you feel good about shutting a team out, but shutting out the Raiders, just not doing it this year. So, yeah, pretenders.
Okay, there's only one NFC West team on this list. I'm sure everyone can guess who this is going to be. The Arizona Cardinals, Samantha. Contender or pretender?
Pretender that probably makes the playoffs because the NFC is so bad. But yeah, I can't with these guys. Like, that they didn't even do their usual thing where they perform really well for the first half of the season and then come apart. Like, do we really think it's going to flip-flop? No, like they do just enough to stay in the conversation, but I've been extremely underwhelmed by them. I'm underwhelmed by Kyler Murray. I'm very underwhelmed by the Cardinals defense. I think they're going to win some games. Maybe very well sneak into the playoffs, but I fully believe them to be a pretender.
Irby, where are you at with the Cardinals?
Contender? Yes, definitely. Definitely a pretender here. 0-3 in the division. The season hangs in the balance this week as they play the Rams. If they can't find a way to win this game, the Cardinals will finish dead last in the NFC West.
Pretenders, well, and McVay owns Kingsbury. Keep that in mind.
It's true.
Even though the Rams are a mess right now, McVay absolutely owns Kingsbury, just like Shanahan owns McVay. Weird, weird thing going on there in that division.
Yeah, the game is in. The game's going to be weird, too, because the game is in L.A. They've already played in Arizona. So the game, the Arizona-L.A. game is in L.A., and I believe the most fan base that will be there will be the 49er fan.
Oh, it's going to be like every game in L.A. where the visiting fans just take over. I mean, East Coast visiting fans take over. So I am sure the Cardinals people can get themselves there.
It's not that far of a drive.
Yeah.
All right. I am also going to call them pretenders. I do not see a contender in Arizona this year. So even as bad as the NFC is, I'm not even sure they can squeak into the playoffs. I don't know. We will find out. All right. That's going to wrap that up. One more to go before we get out of here.
Oh, wait. Okay. So here's a question. Uh-huh. Cardinals or football team?
Oh, I take football team.
For the last spot?
Yeah.
In the postseason?
Yeah.
Football team?
I take football team.
I think I might, too. I mean, just like, can't you just see Taylor Heineke willing it to happen? Like, Kyler Murray never willed anything to happen, so.
Yeah. No, I can see that.
Irby, Cardinals or football team?
Neither, because they're not going to make it. You get that far. I don't think either is even getting, because we're still at 7 playoff teams, correct?
Right, so...
Yeah, so your 7th team right now is the 49ers.
Oh, right, so yeah, Cowboys, Giants, 49ers, you're right. So, okay, so probably...
But between that conversation, I have football team. I think football team can make a conversation. If the 49ers can't figure it out and they feel the need that the 7th seed is where they want to be yet again... I think it's football team that really challenges them over Atlanta, over L.A., over New Orleans, over Arizona, over Green Bay. I just wanted to say Green Bay in there.
Green Bay is not part of this conversation.
The Giants are winning 11 games. They're in. They're in. Easy.
Okay, so you're doing because so the Giants, I think we all feel pretty confident that Dallas is in. So, okay, so that
I've got three in the East. Yeah.
One spot then, which I would be shocked if it didn't go to San Francisco. So, yeah, I guess we can't do that. That's too bad, though. That would have been an interesting conversation, even though apparently it wasn't, because we were all just like, oh, football team.
No, but it's but
I thought it was going to be hard, but it's not.
And it should have been. That's what's crazy is that should have been a conversation this year. And football team is better in that situation than all those teams listed. I just... Arizona, look, the infighting, the Call of Duty play, whatever it wants to be, they're not even close to firing on Pistons. We all know it's wrong. It's just a matter of who's going to lose their job. And Kyler just signed a long-term contract, so take that as you will.
It really should be Steve Keim, but, we just saw this with the Colts. It's not going to be Steve Keim unless they just fire everybody. But I don't know if Kingsbury is going to fix your problems firing Kingsbury.
Okay, so Samantha, we're going to bring back Let's Remember Some Trades one more time. We'll call it the Encore, because that's been such a fun segment throughout the baseball season. Now, everyone out there, don't worry. We've got some really fun stuff coming up that's also going to be interactive for the NFL season. But because Let's Remember Some Trades was a lot of fun over these last few months, we're going to do one more week. So one more trade, Samantha. What do you have for us?
Yeah, last one, guys. So, you never know. You may see Let's Remember Some Trades again sometime in the future. But it is, we are closing up shop for now with the end of the baseball season, moving on to some other really cool stuff. So last trade for Let's Remember Some Trades for 2022. And this is a relatively recent one. I wanted to give all you guys at home one that a little bit easier for playing along to close it out. So we're going to the trade deadline in 2017 here, and one of the teams involved is the Los Angeles Dodgers.
What was the year again?
2017
Dodgers. Okay, so obviously the Dodgers are buyers.
Yes.
Okay, two teams?
Two teams. The Dodgers bought a lot of stuff this year. You guys are going to have to sort out which one it is so that they could go and get cheated out of a World Series.
I was going to ask that. Considering that this is the 2017 Dodgers, am I allowed to go ahead and look this up and cheat, and then we just reveal it like 4 years from now?
Yes.
Yes.
Is that okay?
But you can cheat on it. However, we will not be commenting on this until, let's say, 2025. Is when we will comment on this. Irby will lose the first round draft pick.
Yeah.
No other actions will be taken against him. He will not be taken.
Yeah, because you can't even interview me about it.
Yeah, Irby, this would be a provisional win until we figure out how you cheated, and then we take it away from you.
It's me against the world. Okay.
We will allow fans to throw inflatable trash cans at you. That is, we will allow that.
Can we do
Hold
that?
On, can they also throw beer cans? Can you also throw beer cans?
Yes. But more importantly, Samantha, can we also throw inflatable trash cans at it?
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay, then I'm definitely
we're gonna do this a little better than MLB did and allow for some like vigilante justice from the wronged parties. Rather than just leaving it to the fans. So yes, we will allow direct interaction.
I'm gonna go ahead and let you play the Joe Kelly role in this.
Yes, thank you.
you go ahead and do that. I'll do something else.
Okay.
That's great. Hold on. I'm being buzzed real quick. With 2017 Dodgers, would this happen to be the Yu Darvish trade?
Very good. Actually, I should have dragged that out longer. Sorry.
Sorry.
sorry, everyone at home. I should not have confirmed that so quickly. Since he basically just guessed without any further information.
Well, I'm sorry. There were so many of them. That's why I was like, I'm gonna take a stab at one, and if I'm wrong, it's like, okay, then we, because there's like four or five, isn't there?
Yeah,
like, they were busy.
That year, they were very, very busy. This might have been the biggest one, and I mostly picked it because my two co-hosts here are Rangers guys. We are all Rangers supporters here, so I thought that would be a good way to go out. We have not had the opportunity to do that many Rangers trades this year. We've had quite a few Deans trades. So we're going Rangers on the way out. I'm sorry it's one where you guys were selling. Hate to do that, but...
Yeah, it's all right.
So let's see.
This actually fuels Irby's whole, like, he should be allowed to cheat on this, even though he doesn't have to. But he should be, because Yu Darvish was one of those players that had to pitch in Houston and had to deal with the trash cans and got absolutely lit up.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's all kinds of different reasons for Irby to be able to cheat on this one, even though I don't think he has to. Really don't.
I'm trying to remember, so this is where I probably would have had to have cheated for the other, because the Dodgers also, the other trades they had, they got Curtis Granderson in there, and it was like it was all relief pitchers for the other ones, weren't they?
I don't even remember Curtis Granderson, because honestly, I thought he was retired by then. Like, talk about a guy who never amazed that he was still around in 2017. That is shocking to me. But yeah, all the ones I can think of, and I can think of three that are relievers. It was mostly bullpen help. So this was definitely...
Well, there's one. Hey, if you're good for the fun tangent, because, and I only know this because I love looking these things up and I'm a dork like that, but so one of the trades was Tony Watson, relief pitcher for the Pirates. Do you know who went to Pittsburgh in that trade?
Okay, let me think.
Ooh. those playing at home, feel free to do the same.
Okay. Let me think, because, okay, I'm not going to know it just because I know who was traded for Tony Watson, but, like, if I were making an intelligent guess based on the Pirates' current roster, it has to be O'Neill Cruz.
That is correct.
Wow.
O'Neill Cruz could have been a Dodger.
Poor O'Neill
Cruz. Well, he was a Dodger.
What a terrible. That's so terrible, that poor guy. Oh, man. Can you imagine? Like, can you imagine?
And honestly, it's the only reason I remember this is because I remember him as a prospect. And that's just one of those, like, he was smart enough. He wasn't that close to making a major league roster yet, but this was a guy that we all knew. If he filled in, although he really hasn't filled in to his
body yet.
Where
was he? That he would have been, what, double A at that point?
I don't even think he was that high.
Oh, was he in high A? Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, this is...
He was a 6'7" guy.
Yeah, like, because he would have still been... Because he was a teenager when they got him. So he's probably, because he's, what, 23, 24 right now? So this is still 18, 19. Like, he was a baby. And that's what's crazy, is that at that time, the Dodgers weren't, this was not a bad trade for them. Because it's like, well, we're trading an 18, 19-year-old A-ball kid.
Right, who was not considered a can't-miss prospect.
Correct. Yeah, so, he was a good prospect, but this wasn't like you were.
I mean, not
no.
But that's
well, that's what's beautiful is that we can use hindsight and be like, "Wow, why'd you do that?" Because we needed Tony Watson to win a World Series. That's why we did that.
But then Houston cheated, and we didn't get a World Series.
But yeah, can you imagine O'Neill Cruz, a Dodgers uniform,
a really big Dodgers uniform.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, all right, tangent over. Go ahead.
Okay, that was a good tangent, though. Good job, Irby. Good spontaneous trade. Spontaneous adjunct trade.
Since I did Darvish too quick, we gave everybody two. There you go.
Yeah, so that's right. Bonus trade. Also, this makes me happy because it's the first time I've ever been able to be on the guessing end of this, and I got it right, so I'm pleased. Don't ask me anymore. I want to maintain my 100%.
One for one.
I'm one for one. I'm like those wide receivers that throw one touchdown pass in their entire career. Like, who is it? Oh, it's Danny.
No.
Danny Amendola has a perfect passer rating because he threw two passes and they were both touchdowns.
No, you're going the wrong direction. You're fat guy touchdown catch.
Yeah.
You got one catch in your entire career and it was for a 2-yard touchdown.
Okay, we can do that. I feel like it's easier to buy me as a wide receiver who throws a touchdown pass than as a tackle eligible.
Yes, but you love the fat guy touchdown. So let's
I do the love the fat guy touchdown. That's true. So, okay, I'll be the tackle eligible then. One for one. Corner fade. Wide open.
Just a point of clarification. There aren't people out there that aren't fans of fat boy touchdowns, are there?
Oh, yeah, they're called tight ends.
You know there's some guy out there who cries about that. This is a gadget play. I hate it. Like... Well, I hate you.
Probably some schmuck that's mad because he lost his fantasy matchup by 2 points.
Yeah, right, because his tight end needed 2 points.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well, that is, well, it's also blocky tight ends who are literally like, this is the one time, guys. Come on, let me do it. Like, all I do is block. Let me catch the one pass.
Yeah. I literally just finished reading a book about tight ends. Guys, book recommendation. Buy Tight Ends, The Blood and Guts, which is basically the history of the tight end position. Cannot recommend it enough. So good. Everybody, buy a copy. Read it. But, like, that definitely comes up in there. The like, identity crisis of the blocking tight end in modern football. Like, why do I have to be that guy? All right, on our third tangent, let's return to our trade. now that we've veered off into an entirely different sport. Okay, so you, Darvish, went to the Dodgers. Didn't turn out that well for him or for anyone else who was playing legitimate baseball at the end of that season. So who came back? What what came back to the Texas Rangers here in exchange for Yu Darvish? I'm going to guess, Irby, that you know who all of them are. Bo, you might know who all of them are. I never know with you. Yeah, I legitimately have no idea if he's going to tell me he has no clue who any of the people in the return are, or if he's just going to rattle off all three. Impossible to predict.
I know the headliner.
I know you know who one of them is.
Yeah, I know the headliner. If I remember correctly, it was, three players?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah.
But you know who the headliner is.
I know the
headliner. Hold off on that for now. Let's give people a minute to think on that.
Sure.
So you know who the headliner is. Okay. There are, in fact, two other players.
Well, while Bo's thinking on that, you know what's the funny thing about this? Is like the days leading up to this, when it was like, this was a weird trade because it was like a done deal. Like, there was no really other trade. We all knew the Rangers were going to trade Darvish to the Dodgers. It's just a matter
of
time.
Right, but nobody knew what the return was. That's what I forgot about.
And for the longest time, all throughout the DFW area here, it was, we're going to get Walker Buehler. No, we're not!
No. I remember that, everyone was like, we're going to get Walker.
I'm on board with getting Walker Buehler, but there's no way the Dodgers are that dumb.
Okay, I can't believe anyone was stupid enough to think they were getting Walker Buehler.
Oh, it was hilarious. Like, it was... It was days of it, of like, no, it's going to be Walker Buehler.
Okay, fans are dumb. Okay, so, guys, all right. Tell him who the headliner is in this one.
The headliner was Willie June Calhoun.
Got it.
That was the headliner. Who isn't he back with the Dodgers? We'll get to that, I'm sure, afterwards. I think he actually made it back to the Dodgers at this point.
We will come back to that. No. Well, technically, he's a free agent now, but that's not where he went. Irby, you want to tell us where he went? I'll go over all the details, but I think you know where he went. So when he got DFA'd.
What, after Texas?
Yeah, he got DFA'd and then traded to...
Yes, he got traded to the Giants.
Yeah, he sure did, for Steven Duggar. And then he got DFA'd again. Well, we'll come back to this.
So did Steven Duggar.
So that's a watch.
See, that's the ultimate. Okay. No, that's the ultimate.
Willie June Calhoun really hasn't had much success all around.
The headliner.
It's the ultimate no-win trade. Nobody won that trade. Everybody loses.
Houston won that trade.
Right.
O'Neill Cruz lost this trade, too.
O'Neill Cruz lost this trade. Despite not being involved in this. This trade was won by the Houston Astros and lost by O'Neill Cruz, despite the fact that neither was directly involved. Excellent. Okay. All right. Other two guys. Irby, do you know who both of them are?
Yes, I do.
Bo, do you know who both of them are?
I do not.
Okay. All right, so one of them is a pitcher. One of them is a utility outfield, infield, unclear. hard to say at this point.
Future Gold Glove winner, is that what you're saying?
Utility Gold
Glove. Future fake Gold Glove winner, yes. Fraudulent Gold Glove. Legitimate fraudulent, is that what we're calling? Hyphenated legit fraud. Gold Glove, is that what we're calling that? We'll have to work on that. Let's workshop that. we do have one gentleman who theoretically is eligible for the fraudulent Gold Glove as a utility player. And the other gentleman is a right-handed pitcher. He's also still with the Texas Rangers, Bo, if that helps you at all. He's still on the Rangers. The fraudulent utility player is not. The other one is technically on the Rangers, but I don't know that that's going to be.
And he has pitched in the bigs, though, each of the last 2 years.
Yeah, he was called up in 21 and 22. So, however, I don't know that he is part of the long-term plan.
Hopefully not.
he's not been great. Not great. All right. Bo, do you care to take a shot at either one of these? Or do you want a hint? Or should we let Irby, if he wants to give you a weird hint?
I mean, the only one I could think of in terms of like the super utility infielder is IKF, but I don't think that's where we got him.
No, not as good as IKF.
Oh, okay.
Not that IKF is good, but
IKF was a draft pick.
Yeah, he was originally a Ranger, I think, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Originally a catcher.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that.
Yep. Okay. Then no, I've got nothing on this one. I'm drawing blanks.
Okay. All right. Irby. Well, okay. We'll start with that guy then, since we're just talking about it. Who is the super utility player? Straight.
And the only reason I know this is because I know this trade so intimately, and it is fresh, rather fresh. Give me another 5 years, and I'll completely forget this gentleman's
name. Guys, know. He's actually really good at this game. He gets almost all of them, so don't let his false modesty fool you. He's so good at this.
That would be one Brendan Davis.
Yep. Very good. Very good.
No clue where he is. He's not a Ranger anymore.
But we will get into that. And then who is the right-handed pitcher who is still, as of right now, a part of the Rangers organization?
You taking a stab, Bo, I'm throwing it out.
Man, I got nothing. I didn't even know this Davis kid existed, so.
The pitcher who, better have a heck of an offseason turning around, or one AJ Alexi.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Oh,
good job.
Yeah, he better not be a big part of the future of this team. If he is, then we're just stuck with the Astros for another 10 years. Ouch.
Yeah, so this was not a great trade for anyone. No one won.
Including O'Neill Cruz.
Including O'Neill Cruz, who was not actually involved in this trade.
He's collateral damage.
No one won. No one enjoyed this. Collateral damage includes O'Neill Cruz, all of us who had to watch that World Series, and IKF, apparently, who's unfairly slandered as a piece of the trade. So Yu Darvish, as you know, was posted originally from the NPB. He was originally with the Hokkaido and Nippon Ham Fighters from 2005 to 2011. He was posted by Texas. He was there from 2012 to 2017, although he did not pitch in 2015. Traded to the Dodgers in 2017. 2018, he goes to the Cubs. He's there till 2020 when he is traded to the San Diego Padres, where he has pitched from 2021 until now. Still around, still active, of course. Critical member of the Padres rotation. Willie Calhoun, drafted by the Dodgers in 2015, made a major league debut in 2017 for Texas, was there until 2022, then goes to San Francisco in 2022. He was actually DFA'd by the Rangers, cleared, and then traded to San Francisco back in June for Steven Duggar, as we mentioned earlier. He was then DFA'd again in September, and he is currently a free agent looking for work. AJ Alexi, 11th round pick in 2016 with the Dodgers. He was traded to Texas. He made his debut in 2021, also made appearances in 2022, and as we told you, much to the chagrin of my Rangers fans here, he is still a member of the organization. So we're hoping for the organization decided to make a change moment for AJ Alexi.
I need to add that to my little soundboard here.
We need that.
That's a key part of that movie of Bull Durham that needs to be on our soundboard. Go ahead.
Super utility, future Gold Glove winner in a fraudulent Gold Glove category. Brendan Davis was drafted by the Dodgers in 2015 in the fifth round of the draft. Traded to Texas here. He was with Texas from 2017 to 2020. He was never in the majors. That's all in the minors. On December 20th, he was selected away from the Rangers by the Los Angeles Angels of Baja, Anaheim, California. Of California, of Anaheim, of Baja. In the World 5 draft.
Don't
Don't forget Tijuana.
San Diego. I don't know. We're just expanding out. We're gonna be into Arizona soon, guys. Possibly also into the Pacific Ocean. It just keeps growing. Anyway, picked up by the Angels in the Rule 5 draft. Was in the minors there. Until May, he was then DFA'd and claimed on waivers by Detroit, where he finally made his major league debut in 2022, which went about as well as you would expect for anyone making their debut for the Tigers in 2022. So there you have it. That is our trade, which no one wants. Close out the season. We are celebrating futility, apparently. I don't know what that says about my feelings going into the offseason. I just listened to an episode of RTC2 this morning where Theo Epstein is attempting to sell me the rule changes. And I will tell you that nobody can sell that stuff better than Theo Epstein, but I'm still not on board with the pitch clock. and I foresee problems with the shift banning rule. But exercise in futility. Brings it back to this trade, which was also an exercise in futility. So there you have it. The baseball season goes out with a whimper, which feels appropriate considering the trash cans won the World Series.
Well, again, provisional championship.
Well, yeah, we all know this one. Yeah. We have to figure out what happened.
Until it's confirmed that it was on the up and up, it is a provisional championship.
Agree. I don't think they should be allowed to keep that trophy. I think it was fine for them to take it and have their parade, and then I think they should have to give it back until we've all done our research.
Well, you know, I mean, yes. Let's be honest, you know, Rob Manfred finally got his wish. He was able to turn the World Series trophy into a hunk of metal when he handed it to the Astros.
By devaluing the World Series trophy. He has fulfilled his own prophecy. That's a fair point. great job, Rob. We're all so happy with your work. yikes.
Yikes indeed. All right. Well, fun trade. That's a nice one to cap it off with. We will have some new, fresh content for you next week. Some NFL-related interactive segments for you. For now, though, we're out of here. Until next week, watch some, I don't know, football? College? I think college basketball is back. You can watch some of that too. Whatever gets you through, give that a look. And you know, while you're listening to some Lollygagging Sports, how about you give us a like, a subscription, or a review? Until then, have a great week.